Imagine stepping into a hospital for a routine radiation therapy session, a procedure you've undergone multiple times without incident. The room is quiet except for the soft hum of medical equipment. You lie down on the treatment table, the overhead machine positioned carefully above you. The technicians offer reassuring smiles as they retreat behind their protective barrier. Everything is as it should be. But then, as the machine powers up, an unexpected sensation floods your body. A sudden intense pain, sharp and searing, unlike anything you've ever felt, courses through you. It feels like an electric shock, jolting every nerve. You cry out in agony, confusion, and fear grips you. You run to the door, desperate to escape. The medical staff rush back in, alarms ringing in their ears and panic etched on their faces. They scramble to understand what's happening, but the equipment shows no signs of malfunction. The treatment should have been routine, but you'll be dead in weeks. What just happened? Hey, I'm Dave. Welcome to my shop. Today, we're exploring the harrowing reality that unfolded for several patients treated with the Therac-25 radiation machine back in the 1980s. Designed to be a cutting-edge solution in the fight against cancer, the Therac-25 was lauded for its advanced technology and efficiency. It promised precise treatments, faster sessions, and better outcomes. But beneath its sophisticated exterior lurked a hidden danger, a software flaw that would turn life-saving treatments into life-threatening nightmares. Over the next few years, a series of inexplicable accidents began to surface. Patients were suffering severe injuries during their treatments, but the cause remained a mystery. Medical professionals were baffled. How could a state-of-the-art machine, monitored by trained technicians and cleared by the federal regulatory bodies, inflict such harm? Today, we'll uncover how a combination of software errors, oversight failures, and misplaced trust in technology led to one of the deadliest medical device disasters in modern history. We'll explore the human cost of these failures and the lessons learned that continue to impact how we approach technology and medicine today, and software in particular. The notion of trusting a human's life to a computer was a relatively new one, tracing its way back to the nuclear submarines and NASA rockets of the 1960s. In those cases, excruciating care was taken to prioritize and ensure the safety of the occupants. Being such a new concept, no expense was spared in crafting software that would be fail-safe even unattended in a complex environment like space or the ocean depths. As the decades went by, however, complacency set in and the results were deadly. Unlike its predecessors, the Therac-25 represented a bold leap into the future of medical technology. Earlier models like the Therac-6 and the Therac-20 were built with robust physical safety mechanisms, hardware interlocks that acted as fail-safes to prevent excessive radiation doses. Those mechanical safeguards were designed to detect and correct any anomalies, ensuring that even if something went wrong, patients could not and would not be harmed. However, in an effort to modernize and streamline the machine, the designers of the Therac-25 made a pivotal decision. They chose to replace many of these physical interlocks with software controls. The idea being that software could handle safety functions more efficiently, reducing the need for bulky hardware components. This would make the machine smaller, more cost-effective, and supposedly more reliable due to fewer mechanical parts that could wear out or fail. The reliance on software offered flexibility and innovation. Complex tasks could be managed through code, and updates could be implemented without physical modifications to the machine. It was a testament to the growing trust in computer technology during the era, a belief that software could handle anything that hardware could, and perhaps even better. But this shift came with unintended consequences. The software was entrusted with the critical task of ensuring patient safety, but it lacked the necessary rigor in its development and testing. Unlike hardware, which can be physically inspected and tested under various conditions, software flaws often remain invisible until triggered by a specific set of circumstances. In the Therac-25, one such flaw was a subtle but deadly race condition in the code. If an operator entered commands rapidly, a not uncommon practice in a busy clinical setting, the software could misinterpret the instructions. Specifically, it could skip essential safety checks and configuration steps that ensured the machine was correctly configured before delivering the radiation. Without the physical interlocks to catch this error, the machine could proceed to emit a beam with the intensity intended for X-ray therapy, but without the proper beam spreader in place, concentrating the radiation in a way that was never intended. The impact was immediate and catastrophic. Patients received radiation doses hundreds of times greater than prescribed. Some received doses higher than that experienced by the technicians handling the nuclear weapon Demon Core that went briefly critical in the lab some 40 years before. What should have been a therapeutic treatment became a life-threatening event. The patients felt intense pain described as an electric shock or burning sensation, and many suffered severe radiation burns, tissue damage, and in some cases, fatal injuries. The absence of hardware interlocks meant there was no safety net. The software was single-handedly responsible for preventing overdoses, and when it failed, there was nothing to stop the machine from harming patients. The operators, relying on the machine's indicators and unaware of software flaws, had no way of knowing that anything was amiss until it was far too late. This reliance on software-only interlocks in a life-critical system like the Therac-25 highlighted a significant oversight in safety engineering. It exposed the risks of eliminating redundant safety measures in favor of technological advancement without thorough testing and validation. The tragedy underscored the necessity of multiple layers of protection, both hardware and software, as well as in the development process itself, to safeguard against unforeseen failures. In essence, the decision to adopt software-only interlocks without adequate backup systems set the stage for the unfortunate events that followed. It was a harsh lesson in the importance of designing medical devices with comprehensive safety mechanisms, ensuring that the failure of one component, be it hardware or software, does not lead to disaster. Now, you might imagine that the software control system was developed by a large team of skilled designers, engineers, and testers. But you would be wrong, as the Therac-25 software was reputedly written by a single programmer, a programmer that was apparently more a hobbyist than a seasoned engineer. The identity of the developer has never been revealed and remains unknown to this day. Now, I'm from Canada originally, and the engineers there wear iron rings, tracing their origins back to a bridge that failed and killed 88 workers due to design and engineering shortcomings. The ring serves, at least in part, as a reminder of the professional and ethical duties placed upon the professional engineer. Software engineering can be, and indeed must be, just as rigorous when life and safety are involved. But that was not the case with the Therac-25. The programming was done in PDP-11 assembly language, which, while efficient, is also complex and prone to errors if not meticulously managed. The lack of formal software engineering practices, such as thorough documentation, change logs, code reviews, and comprehensive testing protocols, meant that critical flaws went unnoticed. This casual approach to the software led to several problems, not the least of which was code reuse from the earlier Therac-6 and Therac-20. But because the earlier machines had physical interlocks that the new machine did not, defects in the old software that would have otherwise been caught or blocked by the physical interlocks of the older machines were now free to deliver potentially deadly doses. One of the main issues was the absence of rigorous testing for concurrent operations. As noted earlier, the software contained a race condition, which is a type of bug that occurs when the system's behavior is dependent on the sequence or timing of uncontrolled events. In the case of the Therac-25, if an operator entered commands too quickly, the software could miss essential safety checks. Without hardware interlocks as a backup, these software oversights had nothing to prevent them from causing harm. Furthermore, there was a lack of communication between the software developer and the clinical users of the machine. Reports of anomalies were often dismissed or were not thoroughly investigated, partly because the software developer believed that the code was error-free. This overconfidence in the software's reliability, coupled with inadequate testing procedures, allowed the dangerous flaws to persist undetected. When things did go wrong, the machine did very little to assist the operator in safely resolving it. For example, every error situation was simply listed as a malfunction on screen with a number from 1 to 64 to identify it. Except the error codes were not identified in the manual and were completely undocumented. Operators who had placed their trust in the machine were blindsided by its behavior. They had no way to know whether a malfunction was something minor or a prelude to a catastrophic overdose. The software designed to be a guardian of patient safety was instead a silent accomplice in a series of deadly accidents. The unfolding crisis began to draw attention. A pattern emerged. Patients from different hospitals, different states, each suffering similar horrific injuries. Burns, blister, damaged tissues, all signs of radiation far exceeding safe limits. Medical professionals, faced with these unexplained injuries, started to dig deeper. What was happening? How could a machine cleared by the FDA and developed by a trusted manufacturer and used by trained professionals be causing such devastation? The answer lay buried in the code, a series of errors, misunderstandings, and shortcuts that when combined created a perfect storm. The software had never been fully tested under real-world conditions. The developers had reused old code, assuming it would function as it had on earlier models, without considering the profound differences in design. The lack of formal safety testing, peer reviews, and independent verification allowed flaws to slip through unnoticed. As the number of victims grew, so did the pressure on the manufacturer, AECL, or Atomic Energy of Canada Limited, to explain what was happening. Initially, they insisted that the machine was safe and that the accidents were due to operator error. But as investigations continued, it became clear that something far more serious was at play. Regulatory bodies like the FDA and the Canadian authorities began to scrutinize the Therac-25 more closely. Internal documents from AECL revealed a troubling lack of formal software testing and an almost casual approach to safety verification. The code, which was supposed to ensure patient safety, had been treated as an afterthought. This software, rushed through development, had never been properly stress tested. No one had checked for all possible interactions or timing errors or hardware-software coordination failures. It had simply been assumed to work because it appeared to do so on the surface. By the time the full scope of the problem was understood, the damage was done. Lives had been lost, families torn apart, and trust in the machine, and the very idea of software-based medical safety was shattered. The story of the Therac-25 is a stark reminder of the dangers of overconfidence in technology, particularly when human lives are at stake. It teaches us that no matter how advanced or revolutionary a system appears, it is only as reliable as the care, scrutiny, and humility with which it is built. New regulations were introduced to ensure that such a tragedy could never happen again. The medical device industry learned the hard way that software must be treated with the same seriousness and rigor as any physical component, especially when it serves as a last line of defense in protecting human life. Today, the Therac-25 is remembered not just as a machine, but as a lesson. A grim warning about the cost of shortcuts, the importance of redundancy, and the need for transparency in design and testing. It reminds us that in the quest for innovation, safety can never be compromised. And it serves as a call to every engineer, developer, and designer that behind every line of code, every circuit, and every device are real people, sometimes trusting you with their lives. It is a trust that must never be taken lightly. If you found today's episode to be any combination of informative or entertaining, please remember that I'm mostly in this for the subs and likes, so I'd be honored if you'd consider subscribing to my channel and leaving a like on the video. And if you're already a subscriber, thanks for your support. Be sure to check out the free sample of my book on Amazon, link in the video description. In the meantime and in between time, I'll see you next time, right here in Dave's Garage.
Do it, Glenn! Do it! Do it!